and welcome back to another exciting episode of CUNY Uncut, where we talk about anything and everything. Uncensored, unedited, and uncut. I'm your host, Isabel Ortiz, and today I am joined by a very exciting guest. He's currently a senior at City Tech, and when he's not working on his studies, he is navigating his career as a chef, working at a Michelin-starred restaurant in New York City, as well as running his own supper club called The Sewing Tin. With that being said, I would love to give a very warm welcome to Aditya Mishra. Hi, Aditya. How are you doing today?
I'm doing good. Thank you for having me.
Of course. I am super excited to have you on the show today because literally growing up, I grew up on the Food Network. All things like cooking, Top Chef, stuff like that. So I've always been really interested in people's culinary journeys, you know, because I feel like everybody is different. And especially hearing that you go to a CUNY, like, balancing those two things, I'm sure, is really heavy. But like I mentioned, everybody's culinary journey, I assume, is very different. So what was your journey like? How did it start?
So it started with, same as you, my brother, he was a big food guy. He was always, like, every time we were together in the living room, he used to have, like, travel show on, food shows on. So I used to always watch Gordon Ramsay. I remember Gordon Ramsay, but there was a lot of other chefs. I wouldn't say American chefs, but we used to watch like British TV. I'm from Nepal, so, and that was always interesting to me. And then I remember when I was 15 years old, my dad used to work at a hotel. So I go there and I see these chefs, like, they're wearing big hats. And I'm like, yo, that's so cool.
The hats part was the cool part.
Yeah, that was cool. And then I kind of gravitated towards watching more about like what a chef was, like, shows like No Reservation really, I think, triggered my like interest about what a chef is. And then I read this book, Kitchen Confidential by Anthony Bourdain, and I followed a couple of chefs like Marco Pierre White, Gordon Ramsay, and it was very interesting, like the way they carried themselves. Like, it was like they had this military kind of discipline, but they're also like rock star in their own ways. It was so cool to me. But then I'm from Nepal, so the story for chefs back there is way different than it was in Europe or in America. So I went to my parents. I was like, yo, I don't be a chef. And they're like, no.
No.
No, yeah.
That too, I wondered about, is being a chef like a socially accepted career in Nepal? Because I know like here, it's gaining more respect, really. Would you say?
I think chef has the same kind of stereotype, what do you call it, like way of looking at the career here and Nepal. But
really, okay,
it's just that in Nepal everything is like you're behind, like they're behind like 20 years behind in all the fields. So think about how America saw chefs 20 years ago. That's how it is now. Plus you don't make money as a chef, and you don't really have independent restaurants getting like Michelin stars and accolades, because there's no Michelin star there. Like, they don't know what a chef can be. Like I said, my reality of what a chef is was, it's a cook. Like, you don't do that as a man in Nepal. Like, it's something that you only do because you don't have any money, you need a job, you go wash dishes. And it's the same way here as well, like the way how these traditional chefs came up to be. But until now, like, now they're getting a little like aware about what the possibilities are, but for me that was the reason why I always saw myself coming to New York City to cook. Even when I, like, where I am right now, I planned this when I was 15 years old. That might sound crazy,
you had the wheels turning.
It was like, yo, you know what, I can't be a, because the chefs that I look up to were like performing at a different level that my country didn't provide. So I had it in my head that, okay, I have to be at a good culinary school. Like, I had to be in the best city. I had to be in the top of the, you know, like the field, because if I'm not, I'm working dog hours, I'm not making money, and my whole life's going to be a struggle.
You wanted to be the best of the best in the field, I would assume.
Yeah, that's the goal, you know, like, to be the best that I can be, not to just push myself every day and try to do better.
Very nice. It's nice to see somebody that is young really have that drive to like get to their goals, you know? But you said you always knew you wanted to be a chef. You had the wheels turning from when you were 15. But when it's time to actually go to culinary school, how did you get to New York? What was your journey like?
Okay, I said I had it in my head, but I was very scared.
Okay.
I studied science until I was 19 years old because my parents, like, I just wanted to make everybody happy. Yeah. So that's how I grew up. In Nepal, like, you have a big family.
Mm-hmm.
Like, your mom's side of the family, your dad's side of the family, they're all, like, we're a big joint family. So I used to think about, oh, what my grandfather thought of me, what this guy thought of me, that guy. So I had to play it along, or I did play along, because I wanted to be the good grandkid, you know?
Yeah.
But then I came to America. I told my parents I'll be an engineer. I came to America. I got a scholarship at this university in Louisiana.
Okay.
And I was studying there for a year. Then COVID happened, and I was sucking at it. I was so bad. I remember I had this class about some... I don't even remember, bro. This was this... you have to make, like, modules and stuff on the laptop, and I couldn't do it to save my life. And this guy, he gave me a D. And then I cheated on one of... Because it was COVID and everything was online.
Yeah.
I had... Calculus, I was good when I was in Nepal, but once I got to America, I was just not giving a like damn about it. So I didn't cheat, but me and my friend, we used to do our homework together because everything was online.
Yeah.
And he figured that out, and then he gave me an F.
Okay.
So for me, it was like, you know what? Like, this is not where I want to be. This is not what I'm doing. And then I don't know if you remember, but 3 years back, there was a big hurricane in Louisiana.
Yes.
And in Lake Charles, that's where I was living, and the whole city had to be evacuated.
Really?
And I was by myself in America.
Yeah.
I don't have nobody. So I was basically homeless for a month, and I was just, like, wandering around. By that time, thank God, I had applied to this school in upstate New York for culinary school, because I was like, you know what, like, this is all I've wanted to do. Like, this is my thing. If I don't do it now, like, I'm just gonna...
Do you think too, while like you were in Louisiana in school taking these like engineering classes, was it always something in the back of your head like, I don't want to do this, like, I want to be a chef?
From the first day, I was looking at what school can I go to. But the thing is,
okay. That's
the thing, culinary school is so expensive.
Yeah.
And I can't ask my parents to pay for it because they don't have the money to send me to culinary school in America, because we're talking 40 grand a year.
Yeah,
you know, and they don't give you a scholarship.
Yeah.
And I was thinking of ways like how I can support that for myself while like going to culinary school and all that. So it took me a year to like think about like I said, I like to plan ahead, but then I like to plan like in a way that it makes sense. You know, I can't just like jump into it and then there's no point.
Yeah, you gotta be realistic too. Realistic when you're doing those things. Uh-huh. Yeah.
So yeah. It took me a year. Like, it was always like, since I got to America, the thing is, I landed in New York first. Then I went to New Orleans.
Okay.
But when I was in New York, I didn't even get out of the airport because I was like, yeah, I have to come back here.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it took me a year, and that hurricane and COVID really helped.
Mm-hmm.
And I contacted my school here in upstate. They were like, hey, you don't have anywhere to live, so just come to school. We'll give you a place to stay for 4 months. And I was like, all right, let's go.
You're like, all right, I have my bags, I'm ready.
I packed my bags, and yeah, I moved in like 5 days.
So at this time, do your parents know you are in New York or at culinary school?
I think I told my brother about it.
Okay.
But that was it, because I didn't know what I was getting into, so.
Yeah. You wanted to make sure it was a sound and like secure idea before you let them know.
Yeah.
So being that your career as a chef was somewhat of a point of contention, I guess, with your parents, how do they feel about it now?
I think they're happy. It's just, I feel like they never understood me in a way, but it makes sense because I was a kid, you know, I didn't know what I was talking to.
Yeah.
And I feel like with parents, it's just that how I look at it is they want the best for you from the knowledge that they have had with their life experience, right? So you can't really put that pressure on them like, oh, you didn't. Like, it would have been good for them to, like, support me from the start, but I don't think I would have this push to, like, just...
Yeah.
And just be myself, like, the way I am right now. I don't think I would have been the man I am right now if my parents would have, like, been like, oh, yeah, go do this, yeah.
Yeah, because it was... Because I feel like I'm the same way. So once you get to New York, what is your first job in a kitchen? What did that look like?
I was like busting tables. I worked at the Bronx for a little bit. I was just like, anything that would give me money to survive, because I had to pay for school and all that.
Mm-hmm.
So nothing crossed my mind for at least first 7-8 months.
Okay.
So, and I was in culinary school, but then I hadn't cooked my whole life. And I was with these kids that have been cooking since they were 13. And I was already 20. And I didn't know how to hold a knife.
Okay.
So I was like catching up. So it was a very stressful time.
And it's funny too, because like things like holding a knife, like you wouldn't, me, I mean, I did mention I do watch a lot of cooking TV, so I know, but simple things like holding a knife, knowing the temperature to cook things like that, it's simple things, but I'm sure it takes a while to learn, right? So I wonder too, being that you do have this training at a Michelin star restaurant, you do run your own supper club, do you have you realized that the techniques you might have learned at culinary school or like working in a restaurant transfer at home? Like, can you be making something as simple as an egg and have that kick in?
I think that's the whole point of us doing this supper club at apartments, because I think people love watching cooking shows, but when it's time to cook, they feel like, oh, I'm at my home, I can't do this. So this was the whole point of why we started our supper club. I don't know if you've checked our Instagram.
Yes.
The kind of food that we do is the food that we cook. I cook at my apartment, my chef partner, he cooks at his apartment, and we execute all that in an apartment in New York City.
Yeah, so, which I'm sure is very small.
So that was the whole point of, and right now, like, people watching us do that, they're like, yo, how is this possible? Like, how are you guys bringing these food out from home, like a kitchen at New York City, like a home kitchen at New York City? And
yeah.
I feel like cooking is more about what, it's a very emotional thing. And you'll find a way. You just have to know, like, you just have to have that desire to bring something good, you know?
So you have this supper club, the Sewing Tin. How did that really come about? I know you mentioned you have a partner in it, but how do you guys like talk about menu? Like, what really goes into running a supper club?
So the thing is, we just call it supper club because it's an open end. Like, it doesn't put us on a box.
Yes.
Because I hate being in a box. So the concept was me, my chef partner, he's in medical school. He is a graduate from Columbia. And he cooks for a passion. Me, I cook because it's my life. So we just had this click once we're doing this event in Boston that we both wanted to do something with food and with our passion. So we're like, you know what? His apartment in, I think it was, where was it? Hell's Kitchen?
Hi.
Yeah, we did like 16-seater. We bought a bunch of stuff. We're like, let's play around. Let's create dishes we've been wanting to create. And we just did one of those, like, those supper club dinners, and then it turned out really good. So after that, we're like, you know what? Let's just keep doing this. And how we do this is, for the menu, we do a seasonal menu. So that being said, we look at what's in season.
Okay.
And a small cooking tip to whoever's listening, whatever is in season goes well together.
Okay.
So it's very easy. It's very easy. So that's the thing with cooking. I feel like people are overcomplicated sometimes, but it's very, like, you just gotta have love and not, like, overcomplicate things. And we, that's what we do. We think about what our inspirations are. Like, me, I work at this restaurant, but I also try and go and learn at other restaurants in the city, like, on my days off and stuff. I go stars at other restaurants, and I see how the dishes are made, and just Instagram, like, these days you can just scroll through, get pick like what they're doing, and just then back, take it back to where I'm from and bring that influence into how I want to interpret the same dish and then bring that all together. And we do a trial run, see what's missing, what needs to be added. And I love eating rustic food, but I love curating a very artistic, like, abstract plates and stuff.
So being that you are a chef and you do work at this restaurant and other places too, working under other chefs, I'm sure sometimes, like, you can feel restricted because you have to cook their food. So when you're given the opportunity to cook your own food, does the culinary scene in New York contribute to that? Does your own culture contribute to that? Like, how have you seen those two worlds kind of collide in your food to make a dish?
So whenever I'm at, whenever I walk into somebody else's kitchen, mm-hmm. it's not about me. I'm just a guy doing my job, heads down, cutting whatever needs to be done. Mm-hmm. You know, it's his vision, it's his story. I'm just helping him tell the story from mm-hmm. like best of my knowledge and best of my ability. But when it comes to me doing my dishes, I started cooking, like I said, when I came to New York City. So it obviously, everything I do, there's going to be a part of New York City and part of Kathmandu, Nepal, where I'm from. Mm-hmm. So it's just influence from all that and influence from what I've eaten. I live in Queens, so best food in Queens.
Yes.
Yeah, and then it's all that. And I just try to bring all that together mm-hmm. in a way that I love to do it. That's
awesome. And I think it's cool too, because even the name of your supper club is the Sewing Tin. And I would love if you can like go into a little about what that name is, because I know there's a cultural aspect with that.
Yeah, so shout out to my partner Akhil. He's the one who came up with the name.
Okay.
And so the whole idea was, we're trying to think about name that like resonates with both of us. Mm-hmm. He was born and raised in America to a Indian family. Me, I came from Nepal. We didn't have anything in common, but he talked about this sewing tin, and we're like, oh, sewing tin, the box with like sewing supplies in it. And that was the starting point. But then it grew into something bigger, like the stories of the childhood, like, you know, like mm-hmm. everybody, I feel like you told me the same thing, right? Like,
yes.
You could relate to that box of like, when you look at it, that's how our food is too. When you look at it, it's a European cookie, but yeah. that looks fancy. But when you dive in, there's a component of like where we're from, like our own identity to it, like the sewing supplies in that box
mm-hmm.
that like many yeah. people relate to.
So. And it's nice to hear like that kind of idea transfers through culture, because like I'm Hispanic. And I remember seeing like those butter cookies on like in my kitchen and opening it and seeing thread and being disappointed. Uh-huh. So I think that's awesome that you can like add that level of fun into your food and with the name itself. And then your supper club was named by Thrillist as one of the best under the radar supper clubs in New York City. How did getting that feel?
It's just the beginning. I really didn't feel like anything, to be honest, because I'm still on my underdog days, you know. I'm just getting started.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you get recognized, it's like, okay, we're doing something right.
Yeah.
But it's just, yeah.
It's just the start.
We didn't even really think about it, to be honest, because we're so excited to do what we're doing.
Mm-hmm.
And this happened like after 3 or 4 months into it.
Okay.
So we're not even getting started, to be very honest. Like right now we have a proper team. Like we're mm-hmm. actually like working on where we want to be. Then we're just two dudes cooking at an apartment. So yeah, it was fun.
It was fun, but it was just the beginning for you. You mm-hmm. wouldn't say it was the be-all of it.
Yeah, but it was fun to watch our name, you know? Yeah, it's kind of nice.
That's really cool. And you mentioned, too, that for your partner was a passion, but for you, it's your life.
Mm-hmm.
And you, throughout this interview, have mentioned how your career is taking over your life, but in the best way, not in a negative way. But being that you do have school, you work in a restaurant, you're running this supper club, I'm sure there's a lot of like physical demands, like being on your feet all the time and having to constantly be running around. And mm-hmm. I'm sure there's like a mental aspect too when you're like on all the time. So how has your career really affected your mental space?
I think that I got a little lucky, because growing up I was very insecure about myself, so I started working out when I was 17 years old.
Okay.
So I don't know, like for me it's every morning I try to go work out so that I can like all that mental aspect of me, like if I wasn't working out it would be like I would be depressed or whatever. I just try to have, and also I feel like for me, like coming from Nepal, being here and being able to do all this, it's like I come from a place of, I'm very fortunate, So mm-hmm. I can't really be like, oh yeah, I can't do this. No, like I have to do the best that I can do. And that's how I run. Plus I'm just 24. So.
Okay. Yeah. It's not hitting you yet. Yeah, you would say, okay. Something I wanted to ask you about too is this idea of when you're starting out as a chef in New York City, there's a million restaurants, but I know like it must be a very competitive field to get into. So have you noticed that when you first came here and you were looking for jobs in restaurants, was it a very like cutthroat experience or was it, yeah, come aboard, join our team?
So I never looked for any job, to be honest.
Oh, you didn't? Oh.
Yeah. So when I was, like I said, when I was in culinary school, mm-hmm. I was very busy with school and like just making money on the side to pay for school. But I've never worked at a restaurant. Mm-hmm. And in like halfway through culinary school, I kind of realized culinary school is kind of a scam. It's good for like to get your foot into like what you're getting into. Everything is really good, but the mm-hmm. amount of money you're paying, it's really not worth it.
Okay.
So I was like, okay, I need to go to a professional kitchen and start working because it's a 70,000 hours like job where that's how you learn your craft.
Yeah.
And then I emailed my chef. I was like, hey, I want to come talk to you. And I went there. So I didn't even, like, I was just going to help him out, to be honest. I was to finish my school, whatever. I used to go at 4, just stay till, like, 10, 11. And just, like, helping, like, he was, because his restaurant wasn't open yet.
Okay.
So he wasn't hiring or anything. He was just behind the scenes doing, like, menu tasting. He was, like, basically setting up the kitchen and everything. Mm-hmm. And for me, it was an opportunity to see how things happen. So I was like, hey, you don't have to like worry about anything. I'll just come in. I'll just help you out. Mm-hmm. And then I did that for like 4 or 5 months. And I did my externship there from my school.
Okay.
And that after that, I graduated associate in that school. And then mm-hmm. like my last day of school or something, he called me and he was like, I have a job for you if you want to come back. And for me, like, I've never worked at a restaurant before, and mm-hmm. I wanted to go, like, for me, I always wanted to, like, work for the best of the best,
mm-hmm.
because, like I said, I grew up watching these chefs, but it was also kind of intimidating, because yeah. I'm a brown guy, foreign guy, barely, like, my English, I don't think it's too good, but...
Yeah.
And it was hard for me to just go to, like, a 3-Michelin-star restaurant and be like, hey, I want to work. You know, yeah. So I had to like ease my way into it.
Mm-hmm.
So my chef calling me was like, you know, this is the best Indian restaurant in New York City, in all of America. So I was like, you know what? Yeah, this is the starting point for me. And I love working for him. It's great. So I was like, you know, this is great for me. So I started there. Mm-hmm. And that's how.
That's really cool. Because I guess like along the way, you build that kind of like mentor-mentee relationship. Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh.
So how important are, because I know like networking is a big thing in any career you're in, but how does that really mentor-mentee relationship come in a culinary sense?
I think it's very important. I feel like in this profession, it doesn't matter what school you go to, it matters who you work under.
Okay.
And I feel like for me to work under my chef, like be the first restaurant where I worked at, mm-hmm. I'm very fortunate because the opportunities that I've got and everything. And he also has a really good connections to the industry in New York City and around the world.
Okay.
So I feel like because of that, I've got like chances to stage at a lot of like Michelin star restaurants and all that. So, and I think one of the reasons, like last year I got this James Beard scholar. I was a scholar for James Beard. And yes. I think one of the main reasons for it was also me working at Junoon, and his letter of recommendation helped me a lot. So it's a good thing, you know?
Yeah. You mentioned it, but you are a recipient of the James Beard National Scholar Scholarship for 2023.
Mm-hmm.
When you got that scholarship, how did you feel? Was it just the start? And how have you seen it kind of advance your career at all?
That was a very, very... I was excited about that. Okay. I don't know. Because it was like $20,000 scholarship.
Wow.
Yeah. So...
Mm-hmm.
I was like, now I can just focus on cooking, you know? That's why I started the swing team too, because I was just relaxed. I was like, okay, I don't have to worry about this one now.
Okay. Uh-huh. It gave you kind of like a cushion.
Yeah, cushion to just like, you know, do my thing.
And when you received that scholarship, is there like, opportunities to work with other chefs? Do you create like a network of people who also receive the scholarship? What is that like?
I don't think there's anything like that. It's just it is a big scholarship, and it's mm-hmm. for you to complete your education and okay. further your education.
Mm-hmm.
And I haven't had a lot of like chance to, or any like, what do you call it? Like approach from James Beard for like networking or anything. But
okay.
yeah, I think like further down the line, I mean, I did go work with them for one of the events, but I was the one who was like, hey, I want to come work for you guys yeah. for a day, rather than them called like pushing it. So yeah.
I think that's good too, because you mentioned a lot that you took the initiative. You cold called, you emailed, you were like, listen, let me cook for you. I think that's good if you don't have that fear to really take that initiative, which is good. So something you mentioned that I think is really interesting is, as a chef, you don't get paid.
Much.
You don't get paid much. How has that affected you living in New York City? I know you got this like cushion of James Beard $20 scholarship, but how does you not getting paid much really factor into it? And do you ever feel like, what am I doing this for, because you're not getting paid much?
See, that's the thing. I walked into this, like I said, I've been thinking about this since I was 15, so I yeah. knew what I was getting into.
Okay.
And like a financial advice that I tell myself is, always spend less than you make. That way you never broke.
Okay.
And that's what I run by. So I'm doing a pretty good job.
That's very good advice. What is it like to work in a Michelin-starred restaurant? Because I'm sure that's a very competitive thing for anybody to try to get into. Like, what characteristics do you really have to have in order to make it?
I think if you're just starting, you just have to have a drive to learn.
Mm-hmm.
You just have to be a good listener. Because okay. I feel like a lot of times, like, I struggled with it too.
Mm-hmm.
We feel like it's about us a lot of time in anything. And it's just, I think as long as you're doing your job and like appreciating the feedback that's coming,
mm-hmm.
I think it's not that hard.
That is really great advice. And I think you've given a lot of great advice during this interview for people who maybe want to start a career or who may feel a little hesitant to start. Being that this is CUNY Uncut, though, I'd like to ask one question at the end of every interview, and that is, what is your CUNY survival item? So that can be anything from that helps you in the kitchen or helps you at school. Mine, it's probably very silly, I say in every interview, it's an iced coffee. Uh-huh. I had a very large one today. So for you, what is your CUNY survival item?
I have a notebook in my bag, my pen, mm-hmm. and I drink milk and sugar. And black okay. coffee. Oh, coffee, regular milk and sugar.
Okay.
Like when you go down City Tech, there's this small shop that sells like bagel and coffee. I just grab a bagel and coffee from there. So yeah, it's my okay. notebook, because I like to like sketch a lot when I'm at class. I never pay attention. I'm just like drawing random stuff.
Okay.
So yeah, those three things.
Very interesting. Well, thank you so much for being on CUNY Uncut today to talk about your journey as a chef. This really has been great. You were very inspiring, so thank you so much.
No problem. It was a pleasure.
Well, that is a wrap on today's episode of CUNY Uncut. Thank you so much for tuning in. Make sure to check out CUNY Uncut on social media. And once again, I am your host, Isabel Ortiz. I'll see you guys next time. Bye.